الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. وبعد، so this is our weekly lecture on the seerah of the best of all creations, our beloved Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. We ask Allah سبحانه وتعالى as we gather to study the seerah of Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, expressing our love for the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants us the shafa'ah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم on the day of judgment, inshallah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you for the steps that you have taken to the masjid to join, of course, the salah and then the lecture as well. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it from us all. And it is said that people who are guided to the houses of Allah in dunya, in this world, are those who will be guided to their palaces and homes in paradise, inshallah, in the hereafter. So just as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guided you to the, I showed you the way to the masjid, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, inshallah, by His mercy and favor, will show us all, inshallah, our ways to our places and palaces and good and big homes, inshallah, in paradise. Allahumma amin. So, now Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is 35 years old. So 35 years old Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has not yet started to receive revelation. So he's not yet a prophet until that time when he was 35 years of age. But as we have discussed and as we have come to know before, from his early childhood, Prophet Muhammad Sallam was a blessed person and was not similar to any other human being, human beings. And all his people, his family members, and all the people of Mecca, and all people who have met with him, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, even before his prophethood, they knew that he is a special person and that for him there will be, something special that, will be given to him. His position, his rank is something that is not similar to anyone that has come before or after him, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So, when Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam with 35 years of age, his people, the people of Mecca, were obliged to rebuild the Kaaba. Actually, to knock down its walls and to rebuild it again on the basis and the foundations put by Sayyidina Ibrahim and Sayyidina Ismail alayhim as-salam. And a big problem was about to happen at that time, and Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, by his wisdom and of course by Allah's guidance, the very special guidance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been given to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he could prevent a very big war and a great bloodshed that was going to happen between those people who started to rebuild the Kaaba on the foundations of Sayyidina Ibrahim and Sayyidina Ismail alayhi wasallam. So let's start the story from its very beginning. The people of Mecca at that time were obliged to rebuild the Kaaba because of the, wearing factors of nature, and because the Kaaba building was very old since the time of Sayyidina Ibrahim and Ismail alayhi as-salam. So, the Kaaba walls were weakened, and and also these wearing factors of nature were about to to crack down the walls of the Kaaba. So this is one of the reasons. The other reason why they were obliged to rebuild the Kaaba, because the Kaaba was a roofless building, and this allowed the thieves to go into the Kaaba and to steal its treasures. You know, of course, the Kaaba, when it was built by Sayyidina Ibrahim and Sayyidina Ismail alayhim as-salam, of course, it was meant to be the first place of worship, the first masjid to be put and built on earth for all human beings. And it is so. So, but the Kaaba is not a very big building. So that's why this is the, why we have Kaaba and we have Haram. So people at first they used to pray inside the Kaaba. This was like a masjid. So people used to pray inside the Kaaba. But of course, when you know great numbers of people started to be there, so the Haram started to exist as well, which is the you know the this space around the Kaaba, which is called Haram. It was called Haram as well, the sacred house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, including the Kaaba and its surroundings, you know, this big space to allow all people to come and to pray, you know, around the Kaaba. And some people, until now, they go inside the Kaaba and they pray inside the Kaaba. But anyway, so the Kaaba was a very blessed, you know, building from the time of Prophet Ismail and Ismail. Prophet Ibrahim and Ismail alayhim as-salam, and until the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Though, of course, at the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, before Islam, people of Mecca, yes, they were worshipping some other idols, but they used to know that this Kaaba is the house of Allah. So they used to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they used to associate partners to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They used to worship the idols, and they said, they claimed that they just worship the idols because the idols can take them closer and nearer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But of course, this is false, and because we believe قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدْ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only true God. There is no other God than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But anyway, that's why at that time, though they were mushriks, polytheists, but in the pre-Islamic period, at the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, before prophethood, his people used to respect the Kaaba so much, and they knew that this is the house of Allah. If you remember the story of the Abraha al-Habashi when he desired to destroy the Kaaba, Abdul Muttalib, the grandfather of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Oh Allah," he made dua. He took a group of people with him to the Kaaba, and he made dua, as we have mentioned this, and he said, "Oh Allah, every one of us protects his house, and this is your house. So Allah, protect your house." And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course, accepted his dua, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala desired and willed to protect the Kaaba, because this is the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is the sacred house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and first masjid built on earth. So the people of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam desired to keep the Kaaba against, you know, all these you know, factors that may lead to the full destruction of the Kaaba. So they decided just to knock down the walls until they reach the foundation put by Prophet Ibrahim and Ismail alayhi salam, and then the foundation, they would keep it as it is, and they would just build the walls again, rebuild the walls above and over these foundations that were put by Sayyidina Ibrahim and Sayyidina Ismail alayhi salam. Also, one of the reasons why they were obliged to rebuild the Kaaba at that time, because when the Prophet ﷺ was exactly 35 years old, a big flood hit Mecca, and the Kaaba was almost demolished. Was almost demolished. The walls were almost demolished, but the foundation were there, or was there. So now they decided to use only licit money, only lawful money, for the rebuilding of the Kaaba. So they excluded any money that has come from usury or from any immoral means or unjust practices. They excluded this money. So, subhanAllah, they were polytheists, but they were wise people. And this is also, you know, because when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually intends to honor something, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honors it just simply because He wills for this thing to be honored. So Allah willed for the Kaaba to be honored. So that's why He put in the hearts even of those polytheists not to use any haram money for the rebuilding of the Kaaba. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala desires something, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells it, kun fayakun, just be, and then it is as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills it to be. And at first, they were too fearful to knock down the walls that remained. Of course, some of the walls were already demolished by this flood. But, you know, also, you know, some other, in other parts of the Kaaba, walls were there as well. So they were fearful, too fearful to knock down these walls because they thought that this is the house of Allah. And if we knock down any wall, even for the purpose of rebuilding it, but maybe something, punishment from Allah may, you know, be, you know, inflict upon us or hit us or strike us. So one of them, whose name was Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira al-Makhzumi, he started the walk. He took an axe and he said, Allahumma la nuridu illa al-khayr. Oh Allah, we are just doing this for a good purpose. Not because we are against Kaaba, but we will knock down these walls to rebuild it, to make it nicer and stronger. And to build the roof so that thieves do not go into the Kaaba and steal its treasures. So he knocked down one part of one of the walls of Al-Kaaba. And then all of the people, they waited for one full day, keeping their eyes on Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira al-Makhzumi, whether he will receive a punishment from Allah or not. So they waited for one full day. Then next day, when they were sure that he was okay, all right, nothing bad happened to him, no punishment was given to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then they started working with him. Knocking down the walls of Al-Kaaba to reach the foundation that was put by Sayyidina Ibrahim and Ismail alayhi salam, and to rebuild the walls again, you know, in a stronger manner. Then, when they were about to rebuild the new walls, they divided the work amongst them, you know, because this was, you know, for the honor of the participants. Okay, so different tribes, all of them, they like it to share this great honor of being, you know, amongst those who rebuilt the Kaaba. So now they reached the foundation of Sayyidina Ibrahim and Sayyidina Ismail, and they had to rebuild the walls on the foundation. So they divided the work. They said, tribe of so and so, you know, you have this part of this wall, this is your responsibility. And the other tribe, you have this part. And that tribe, they divided it amongst them so that all of them get the honor of rebuilding the Kaaba. And all the work that they had done was that they collected stones. And of course, you know, sometimes they paid money for this, as we have mentioned. So that every tribe collected the stones for its part. And then every tribe gave the stones to a mason, and he was a Roman one. He was not an Arab. He was a Roman one, a Roman mason called Bakun. So he was the one who rebuilt the walls of the Kaaba. All the tribes just collected the stones for their parts, and they gave the stones, their stones, to Bakum, this Roman mason, and he did the job. He built the walls of the camp. And work was done perfectly in harmony and no problem at all. But then problems started when they came to the place where Al-Hajar Al-Aswad should be put. You know, the black stone that when we go to make Hajj, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us all, inshallah, to go and make Hajj, inshallah, to make Umrah, inshallah, so several times, inshallah. May Allah accept it from us all, and may Allah accept Hajj and Umrah from those who have already done it. And so when they reached this part of the Al-Hajar Al-Aswad, and they differed, which tribe should be given the honor of putting Al-Hajar Al-Aswad in its proper place. So every tribe desired to get this honor for itself. So they started to, maybe they were about to fight against each other. And they, you know, there was a big tension amongst them for about 4 or 5 days, as the biographers tell. 4 or 5 days, each tribe would claim for itself the, you know, its right to get the honor of putting the Hajar al-Aswad in its place. So subhanAllah, though they were non-Muslims again, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again put in their hearts, you know, the understanding of the high status of al-Hajar al-Aswad. And again, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala desires to honor something, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honors it. In the Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ يُهِمِ اللَّهُ فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ مُكْرِمٍ. And whosoever Allah humiliates, no one can give him honor. You know, because, you know, if someone has so much money and has, you know, a beautiful wife, for example, and strong children and a big house and has all the luxuries of this life, but he is disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not pleased with him. So this one in reality is a humiliated person. He's not an honored person. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Holy Quran says, مَنْ كَانَ يُرِيدُ الْعِزَّةَ فَلِلَّهِ الْعِزَّةُ جَمِيعًا. Whosoever seeks glory, then from Allah comes all glory. And all glory belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is a stone, just a stone. You know, when Allah desires to give His blessings, you know, and this glory and this, you know, high status to something, even if it is just a stone, it's just a stone. But all of the tribes of Mecca were about to fight against each other, and a very big and bad bloodshed was about to take place because of that stone. So the lesson that we take here is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who gives you happiness or high status in world, of course, and in the hereafter. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one also when He is not pleased with someone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one who takes from that person every happiness and every glory. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst His pious worshippers and slaves who are given all the happiness by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because all of the happiness is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and who are given all glory and all tranquility and all repose and peace of heart and mind by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And actually, Al-Hajar al-Aswad, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-Hajar al-Aswad min al-Jannah, the black stone is from paradise. And in another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, نزل الحجر الأسود من الجنة وهو أشد بياضا من اللبن فسودته خطايا بني آدم. The Hajar Aswad has been descended from paradise and it was whiter than milk. But the sins of the children of Adam, the offspring of Adam, turned it into a black stone. So it was originally it was white, as Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said. But anyway, it has come from paradise, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His will, you know, to honor al-Hajar al-Aswad, though it's just a stone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not only put in the hearts of Muslims the love for al-Hajar al-Aswad, but He put this in the hearts of the polytheists, who afterwards, some of them, they were the severe enemies of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But at the same time, they knew the high position and rank of al-Hajar al-Aswad. Okay, now, war was about to happen and to take place between them. Each tribe claiming the right of putting the al-Hajar al-Aswad on its proper place for itself, and not accepting any other tribe to do this job. So now, one wise man amongst them, whose name was Abu Umayyah ibn Mughira al-Makhzumi. He was an old man. And he had an idea. And he told them about his idea. He told them be calm and be quiet and just wait for the first person that is going to enter al-haram, you know, this sacred area around the Kaaba, and let us agree on his decision. So his suggestion was that all the tribes should wait and look who will be the first one to enter al-haram. And that first person that's going to enter al-haram, they will tell him about their problem and he will give them a decision and they will follow his decision. So they agreed on that. They agreed on that. And then it was again Allah's will and Allah's desire that the most beloved person to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the most honorable person and the most honorable of all the created beings sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was the first one to enter al-haram. And once they saw our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they all said in one voice, they said, هذا الأمين رضيناه هذا محمد. They said, oh, that is the trustworthy. We are very happy that he will judge amongst us. And we are very happy to follow his decision. This is Muhammad. Which this gives us so many lessons. Amongst them, the first thing, the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, you know the consensus, agreement. All of the people of Mecca, they all agree that he is maybe the best person amongst them. They were very happy when he was, when he came and entered the Haram at that time, and when they came to know that he will give them a decision, they were very happy, you know. And you know, now if you have a problem, are you going to tell any ordinary person about it to help you solving it? No. You will choose the one that you think he is the best person who can give you a good advice. So they all were very sure that Prophet Muhammad was the best person who was able to give them the best advice. And he is the trustworthy and the truthful. And he is the one who will do justice amongst them all. And he is the one who is wise, so that he will be able to solve this problem that for 4 or 5 days they were not able to put an end to. So he was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And again, another lesson is that Al-Hajar al-Aswad that came from paradise, that has all this high status in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, was not to be put in its proper place by anyone else other than Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the most beloved person to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you know, this is the planning of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We can take this lesson as well. You know, don't be worried in this life. Allah is planning everything for you. Just be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do your best to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Take the way to Allah's pleasure. We all do commit mistakes because of our weak nature. If you have done something wrong, then repent as soon as you can and go back to your way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to Allah's blessings. Live under the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if when you do so, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will plan for you. Allah planned for a stone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala planned for a stone. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course, is planning for every one of us and is giving us the best plans, especially when we obey him subhanahu wa ta'ala, and especially when our aim in this life is to please him subhanahu wa ta'ala, and when we give this priority over all our other purposes and aims in life. We are in this life to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And don't worry, when you try to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this world, you are achieving all good things in all different spheres in life. This is one side of the beauties of Islam. So you know, for some of the previous scriptures, followers of other religions, they were sometimes commanded to make tawbah, to kill themselves in some other religions. But in our religion, don't worry, just follow the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do your best to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah is not going to ask you to do anything harmful to yourself. Allah is not going to ask you to do anything you know, that will not please you in this world or will be against yourself or your family members or even your, you know, your financial, you know, affairs in this world. All the teachings of Islam are for our well-being in this world and in the hereafter. Okay, now Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a very wise idea, and why not? And he is the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was guiding him from the very beginning. وَوَجَدَكَ ضَالًا فَهَدًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this verse is especially, you know, of course, as you know, this Allah is speaking to what, to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this is the special guidance that was given to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that gave him light in all the different angles of his life. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, without any hesitation, he didn't ask them for some time to think about it. He didn't tell them, oh, give me some time to think about this. It's a very serious problem. I'm not prepared to solve it. No, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, once they sought his advice, he told them, bring me a mantle. And then he himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, took the black stone. He first spread the mantle, and then he took the black stone and he put it in the center of this big mantle. And then he ordered them. You see, Prophet Muhammad is 35 years of age. And those people, some of them are over 70 and over 80 years old. And they are the chiefs of all the tribes of Mecca. And Mecca at that time are the people who were serving the Haram and the people of the best reputation in the Arab Peninsula. Now, who is ordering them and they just following and obeying his orders? Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this was before prophethood, not after prophethood. This was even before prophethood. He commanded them, each representative of each tribe should hold the mantle from one side, from all the different sides of the mantle. And then he commanded them, now you all lift this mantle containing the black stone in central of it. Just lift it up. They lift it up until they reach the proper place where the black stone should be put in. Then Prophet Muhammad ﷺ himself, by his own hands, Sharifa, he took the black stone and he put it in its proper place. And by doing so, Prophet Muhammad ﷺ solved the problem. And they were all happy. Now all the tribes participated in putting the black stone in its proper place. So all of them got the equal honor, because this was their intention, just to, you know, to get the honor of being the one who put the black stone in its proper place. So all of them got the honor that they were after. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself was the one who put the black stone by his hands in its proper place. So when you go, inshallah, to make Hajj or Umrah, you remember this, inshallah. When you point to Al-Hajar Aswad and say, Bismillah, Allahu Akbar, Allahumma imanan bik wa tasdiqan bi kitabik, until the end of this dua, you start your tawaf round the Kaaba, you remember that now you are pointing to the black stone that was put by the hands of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this place. So now, this great danger of the big fight was averted by the, alhamdulillah, the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and through the wisdom of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was about 37 years of age, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to contemplate and to reflect on more and more. You know, in retirement, he used to go to, you know, the cave of Hira in the Jabal, in the Mount of An-Nur, which was 2 miles far from Mecca. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to go there, you know, just to, he used to take with him sawiq. Sawiq is barley porridge and water. and he used to be there, to go there and spend several nights and days, especially during the month of Ramadan. And Prophet used to contemplate and to reflect on the creatures around him, the sun, the moon, the heavens, the earth, and he used to make dua. He was not feeling, you know, happy with the, of course, with the practices of his people regarding the way they used to worship the idols and some of their, you know, moral failures. Prophet Muhammad, of course, was not happy with all these things. And he knew from his deep insight that there is a true God that should be worshipped, and that there is no God but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the true God. But Prophet Muhammad until that time didn't have any clear guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's why he used to go to the Mount of An-Nur and to the cave of Hira. And the cave of Hira was very you know, small in size, you know, it was it was about 4 arms length long. 4 arms length long. And it was 1.75 length wide. So this place was not, it was, you know, a small place. But Prophet Muhammad Sallam used to go there, you know, and used to be alone there and to confine himself to this place to contemplate the, you know, the universe around him and to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide him. And also, during the 6 months just before Muhammad Sallam, the Prophet Sallam reached his 40 years of age, signs of prophethood used to appear with the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, so that the stones used to greet him Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in Mecca. Stones used to greet the Prophet Muhammad Sallam, to say salam to him Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in Mecca. And Prophet Muhammad Sallam, whenever he would see a dream, this dream would come, you know, in reality, exactly as Prophet Muhammad Sallam saw it, as clear as dawn, as the narration says. And this continued for 6 months. And this was a preparation for Prophet Muhammad Sallam to receive the revelation. So, from this, we can take some lessons as well. You know, that if you would like to make good achievements in this world and to be able to take the straight path to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and also the straight path in this world of achieving every success in this world, so you have to do two things. The first thing is to shun all evil practices of all other people. Don't copy them, don't imitate them, because this was the nature of Prophet Muhammad Sallam. He was a young man like some of yourselves now, our sons who are sitting here. Prophet Muhammad Sallam, he was also a young man. He was, you know, as any other human being, he was 15 years old, 20 years old, 25 years old, and the atmosphere around him was corrupt, corrupted, you know. They used to have illegal sexual relations, they used to have usury, they used to have many bad practices were widespread at the time of Prophet Muhammad before Islam. But Prophet Muhammad used not to copy any bad thing, and used not to copy any person who would do any of these bad practices. So this is the first thing. The second thing is that Prophet Muhammad used to plan for himself. Even, you know, no guidance was given to him, but even before he started to receive revelation, he has no guidance, or he had no guidance, no Quran has started to be revealed to him. But Prophet himself planned for himself. He went to the cave of Hira, and he went to this isolated place. You know, I used to spend several nights there in Ramadan for 3 successive years, just to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, guide me. I feel from my inside that, you know, idols must not be worshipped, but I need to get a clear way how to worship you, O Allah. So, contemplation also, contemplation and you know, and the planning. Of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guided the Prophet, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides everyone in this world, all good people in this world, but you know, we have to do our best as well. So it's to think. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to go to Bahira to contemplate, to reflect on the creations and to think of who can be the true God and so on. He used to ask himself these questions. So also we can take a lesson from this, that we have to do these two things, to shun all evil practices, not to copy bad people. It's their business. We make dua for them, may Allah guide them. But we don't copy them, because we know this is a bad thing, then we don't do it. This is the first thing. The second thing, that we contemplate, we think. We don't spend our time, you know, for nothing, or waste our time. No, we think, we put plans for ourselves. And also we seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and from our parents and the elders. The Prophet sought help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, alhamdulillah, you seek help, of course, first of all, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you seek help from your father, from any you know, specialized person in any field that you like to you know, to go in and to study or whatever. So alhamdulillah, you know, our situation now is easier, I can't say. And you know, at the time of Prophet Muhammad sallam, there was no Quran, and Prophet Muhammad sallam was making dua, oh Allah, give me the guidance. Now we have the Quran, and we have all the experiences of all good people who live with us in our family or our teachers or whatever. So alhamdulillah, inshallah, we inshallah do our best inshallah. And these are applicable for religious matters and for secular matters as well, because as a Muslim you have to be a strong personality in all different fields of life, and this is, you know, what Islam is asking us to do. So inshallah, I will stop here inshallah, and we will continue next Tuesday, inshallah. Okay, so I think it's time for Adhan. Do you want to make Adhan and then time for Adhan? Okay. Not yet? Okay. Okay, 10 minutes remaining. Okay, okay. Anyway, we make dua, then we give you some little time before the salah. Inshallah, inshallah, we make dua for all Muslims and for ourselves, and also for some of our brothers who I have been told that they have some health issues. Our brother Ata Rahman, he's in hospital. He has some serious things, and he is in hospital. So please make dua for him. We will make dua for him. Also, one of the old friends of brother Badr Zaman, his son, who is 18 years old, also is in hospital in serious condition. So we make dua for them. Also, okay, brother Mahbub, his son as well, has something. So inshallah, we make dua for all of those brothers and for ourselves, yes? Your son as well. Okay, okay. So we make dua anyway, and that's why we have to keep making dua all the time, inshallah. And when you make dua for yourself, and you make dua for all your brothers. If you remember their names, you mention their names. If you don't remember their names, you say, oh Allah, give shifa and give success and protect all my brothers and sisters in Islam and all those who have asked me to make dua for them. So, Allahumma laka alhamdu kama yanbaghi li jalali wajhika wa 'azimi sultanik. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammadin fil awwalin wa salli ala sayyidina Muhammadin fil akhirin wa salli ala sayyidina Muhammadin fil mala'i al-a'la ila yawm al-din. اللهم إنا نسألك الجنة وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل، ونعوذ بك من النار وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل. اللهم لا تدع لنا في ساعتنا هذه ذنبا إلا غفرته، ولا ضالا إلا هديته، ولا سائلا إلا أعطيته، ولا مبتلا إلا عافيته، ولا مظلوما إلا نصرته، ولا هما إلا فرجته، ولا مريضا إلا شفيته. اللهم لا تدع لنا في ساعتنا هذه مريضا الا شفيته، اللهم اشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين، اللهم اشف مرضانا اجمعين، اللهم اشف مرضانا اجمعين، اللهم رب الناس اذهب البأس، واشف انت الشافي، واشف انت الشافي، واشف انت الشافي، لا شفاء الا شفاءك، شفاء لا يغادر سقما. نعوذه بعزة الله وقدرته من شر ما يجد ويحاذره، نعوذهم بعزة الله وقدرته من شر ما يجد ويحاذره، نعوذهم بعزة الله وقدرته من شر ما يجد ويحاذره. نسأل الله العظيم رب العرش العظيم أن يشفيه، نسأل الله العظيم رب العرش العظيم أن يشفيه، نسأل الله العظيم رب العرش العظيم أن يشفيه. اللهم عافهم في أبدانهم، اللهم عافهم في أسماعهم، اللهم عافهم في أبصارهم، اللهم عافهم في قواتهم، اللهم أذهب ما نزل بهم من أمراض أو أسقام أو أوجاع أو آلام، وأبدله مكان ذلك صحة في أجسامهم وعافية في أجسادهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم اشفهم واشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين أجمعين. اللهم عافهم واعف عنهم، اللهم عافهم وعافنا واعف عنا وعنهم. اللهم نسألك العفو والعافية في الدنيا والآخرة، اللهم نسألك العفو والعافية والمعافاة في الدين والدنيا والآخرة، اللهم نسألك حسن الخاتمة، اللهم نسألك حسن الخاتمة، اللهم اجعل خير أعمالنا خواتمها، وخير أيامنا يوم أن نلقاك فيه، اللهم أصلح لنا ديننا الذي هو عصمة أمرنا، وأصلح لنا دنيانا التي فيها معاشنا، وأصلح لنا آخرتنا التي إليها معادنا، واجعل الحياة زيادة لنا في كل خير، واجعل الموت راحة لنا من كل شر، اللهم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك، اللهم يا مصرف القلوب اصرف قلوبنا بطاعتك، اللهم ألهمنا رشدنا وقنا شرور أنفسنا، واعزم لنا على أرشد أمرنا، اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه، وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه، اللهم إن أردت فتنة بخلقك فنجنا إليك غير مفتونين، اللهم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك، اللهم يا مصرف القلوب اصرف قلوبنا لطاعتك، ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار، ربنا اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا، وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين، ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قوة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما، وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. جزاكم الله خيرا، and please keep in your دعاء remembering those brothers إن شاء الله. جزاكم الله خيرا، سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك، أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت، أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والعصر، إن الإنسان لفي خسر، إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. صلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه.
إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليماً.